I remember Martin Amis saying something about you reach 40s, your 40s or a middle age, and nobody ever tells you, nobody's ever told you, you know, what it's like. Well, it's the same about knowing about death. We all, we're the one animal that knows we're going to die. And yet we carry on, you know, paying our mortgages, doing our jobs, moving about, behaving as though there's eternity in a sense. And we forget or tend to forget that life can only be defined in the present tense. It is, and it is now only, you know. I mean, much as we would like to call back yesterday and indeed yearn to and ache to sometimes, we can't. It's in us, but we can't actually, it's not there in front of us. And however predictable tomorrow is, and unfortunately for most people, most of the time, it's too predictable. You know, they're locked into whatever situation they're locked into. Even so, no matter how predictable it is, there's the element of unpredictable. You don't know. The only thing you know for sure is the present tense. And that nowness becomes so vivid to me now that it's almost in a perverse sort of way, I'm almost serene. You know, I can celebrate life. Below my window in Ross, when I'm working in Ross, for example, there now at this season, the blossom is out in full now there in the west early. There's a plum tree. It looks like apple blossom, but it's white. And looking at it, instead of saying, oh, that's nice blossom, you know, now, the last week, looking at it through the window when I'm writing, it is the whitest, frothiest, blossomest blossom that there ever could be, you know, and I can see it. And things are both more trivial than they ever were and more important than they ever were. And the difference between the trivial and the important doesn't seem to matter. But the nowness of everything is absolutely wondrous. And if people could see that, you know, there's no way of telling you. You have to experience it, you know. But the glory of it, if you like, the comfort of it, the reassurance, if not that I'm interested in reassuring people, you know, bugger that. The fact is that if you see the present tense, boy, do you see it. And boy, can you celebrate it, you know?
You said earlier that it wasn't to do with believing that life was eternal, but have you any feeling that from position you're in that it might be? You said that you've never quite thrown off the idea of believing in God, and it features in a lot of your
work. Well, yeah, I don't know about... Yeah, God's a rumour, if you like. God is... I mean, this kind of Christianity, or indeed any other religion, that is a religion because of fear of death, or hope that there is something beyond death, does not interest me. I thought, you know, what kind of cruel old bugger is God if it's terror that is the, you know, is the ruling edifice, if you like, the structure of religion. And too often, for too many people, it is. Now, that to me isn't religion. Religion has always been, I've said it before, it doesn't matter that I repeat myself, I won't get many more chances to repeat myself, thank God. But the religion to me has always been the wound, not the bandage, you know. I don't see the point of not acknowledging the pain and the misery and the grief of the world. And if you say, but God understands, or through that you come to a greater appreciation, I mean, I then think, well, you nasty old sot. You know, if that's God, that's not God. That's not my God. That's not how I see God. I see God in us or with us, if I see at all. Is some shreds and particles and rumors, some knowledge that we have, some feeling why we sing and dance and act, why we paint, why we love, why we make art, you know. All the things that separate us from the purely animal in us are palpably there. And you can call them what you like, and you can theologize about them, and you can build great structures of belief about them. The fact is they are there. And I have no means of knowing whether that there-ness, in some sense, doesn't cling to what I call me.